And with us right now in our first segment, we have what we call the three representatives of Thinking Matters, as we call it in USM. Thinking Matters is really a variety of opportunities for students to show, for example, undergraduate research that they do with students, and we have a student here to do that. And it more generally gives students opportunities to show projects that they're doing at the university. So with us immediately to my right is Dr. Rebecca Nisetich. She is, among being a faculty member, is also the honors director. Welcome.
Thank you.
And to her right is Hannah Burgess. Hannah is a senior this year. She's from Wells, Maine, and she is a communications and media studies major. And she's just done a really cool project that we want to come back to on how we communicate non-verbally over digital media. And that may sound like an oxymoron, but she's got a really good way to explain it. And to her right is Dr. Maureen Ebben, and she is our assistant professor at our Communications and Media Studies program, and she has been a guide, a North Star for Hannah's work, so we'll be talking to all of them. Let's start off with you, Rebecca. You started the honors program last year, mm-hmm. and we're seeing a huge explosion in the honors program, mm-hmm. And congratulations to you on that. And specifically, you've had a role in Thinking Matters, because a mm-hmm. lot of your students really are engaged in this kind of work. Mm-hmm. Tell us what Thinking Matters is and kind of what's important about it from your perspective.
Sure. I think one of the interesting things about Thinking Matters at USM, it was actually started by a student and a faculty member. Mm-hmm. It was an undergraduate student and a history professor. Mm-hmm. And the student said, I really want to be able to present my work in public. I want to share what we're doing in this class with my friends. And it was Adam Tuchinsky, who's now dean of the College
like
of
Adam.
Arts, Humanities, and Social
job.
Sciences. And so Adam put together this small conference, and he called it Thinking Matters. Mm-hmm. And that was about 16 years ago. And since then, the conference has sort of grown and expanded to include students across USM, also graduate students at USM in the Muskie School and other places. And then I took this conference over when I first started at USM as assistant director of the honors program. And I was really keen to ensure that it was expansive and that it was really not just an opportunity for students to share their work with each other, but that it was a professionalizing opportunity so students could share their work with community partners. We have a lot of students doing service learning projects, a lot of students doing pre-professional projects, so engineering students building jet engines and things like that.
And the research about mm-hmm. students having a good experience at an undergraduate is directly correlated to whether they did a long-term project, usually right. under the guidance of a professor, and something that was authentic and meaningful to mm-hmm. the community at large. And Hannah, you've kind of done that, because mm-hmm. we're all curious about how we communicate with it. I always feel like I'm always reluctant to do too much email, because I feel like I never really am able to affect the kind of tolerant, patient tone that I want to have, and it always sounds snarky sometimes, and so you have to be very, very careful. Hannah, tell us a little bit about your project and how you kind of thought this up, and what did you do to kind of execute it and get it going?
Yeah, so when Maureen approached me about doing Europe, I was like,
Make sure we tell everybody what Europe is. And it's not that continent over there on the other side of the
problem. Right, exactly. University, is it undergraduate?
Mm-hmm.
See, I don't even know what it is. Undergraduate Research Opportunities Program.
Yeah, so it's opportunities for undergraduates like you to do real research, which
right.
professors love.
So, yeah. So Maureen approached me. She asked me, would you be interested in doing this project? And I was like, this looks really cool. And I started reading on the page, the webpage for Europe, and everything looked really interesting, and I had to come up with an idea. So what was I gonna do? And so I'm a communications major, and the whole world is on the internet, and just like what you said, people have to think about how they're gonna phrase stuff or do stuff online in this platform that doesn't give you a face or a body to communicate to.
Right.
So I was like,
but
well,
you found out we do communicate nonverbally.
We do.
Tell us a little bit about that.
So nonverbal is your cues, so your face and your eyes and your body language, all of that. So and your tone of voice.
Sure.
So I was looking at, well, how do people do this? And it's through emojis and through, you know, memes, and we have reaction pictures for a reason
online.
This is something that everyone can relate to.
As social creatures, we're watching each other all the time, like, oh, is this person upset at me or not upset? And you get online, you're kind of like, yeah, this seems kind of stiff and informal. Are they upset? And the truth is, they're just trying to get this out fast or something.
Right, like that, exactly. Yeah. And that's what a lot of people said. So I rounded up 15 people that I knew, which is an opportunistic sample, so they were close to me. Mm-hmm. And so I had to schedule interviews with these people, sit them down, record it on an audio, and then go home, transcribe it, do content analysis, figure out, so what are they really saying about their usage?
Interesting.
Who is using it? How?
Yeah. Wonderful. And you were under the guidance of Dr. Ebben. Dr. Ebben, tell us a little bit about your role in helping Hannah and why you particularly are involved in helping students with undergraduate research.
Yeah. Well, I'm a big fan of undergraduate research. I think, you know, it's never too early to start doing research. And you're
Are you trying to make her a PhD?
Well, maybe.
You know,
maybe.
Let's not ruin these people.
Right. So. She has so much going for her.
Exactly.
Yeah. But, you know, Hannah, one semester was a student in the communication research methods class that I teach, and she's an outstanding student. And as she mentioned, you know, I approached her about this opportunity and said, you know, I don't know if you know, but we have this Europe opportunity for students like you. And I was so pleased that she was willing to do it. And, you know, I think research, of course, is challenging, but also very rewarding. And for my role as a faculty mentor, you know, I'm there on the sidelines, I'm asking questions, have you thought about this, have you considered that? And I think, you know, Europe offers students an opportunity for that sustained year-long. Mm-hmm. It's not just a semester. It's not just a project for a part of a semester. It's a whole year long, you know. So it's persistence, it's resilience, it's endurance, And I think even, you know, the best laid plans, you know, every research project, you design it, you frame it, you have your methodology, but things always happen.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And so I think part of that is just being there to encourage.
Give us an example of anything that happened.
Well, this was a qualitative and interpretive project, and the methodology was some analysis of naturally occurring social media, but it was also interviews.
Okay.
And, you know, Hannah identified people, contacted them, lined up interviews, lined up venues for interviews. Some people showed up, some people did not show up.
Right.
And, you know, and so I think there is that day where you feel very demoralized, but you also have to kind of the next day pick yourself up and persist. So I think, you know, like so much of research, we know a lot. We have methodology. We talk about data. We talk about analysis in very explicit ways.
Right.
But there are other parts of research that are kind of intangible.
Yeah.
But, you know, like resilience and persistence.
Yeah.
And I think they're kind of invisible, but they're essential.
So we're seeing that. More generally, I mean, we hear a lot about, in this country, a lot about graduate research, right? Mm-hmm. So, and it was a lot of money from the federal government even goes in, although less than it used to be, but still a lot of money goes into research at the graduate level. Mm-hmm. Why do any of you think it's so important for undergraduates to have that experience?
I think one of the things that's most important about cultivating research at the undergraduate level is that this is often a student's first opportunity to take on a project in an independent way. So when Maureen approached you and said, hey, what would you like to study? That might have been one of your first opportunities to really think about, like, taking the learning that you had inside the classroom and really applying it to a question that you create yourself. That's really important for students that want to go to graduate school. It's also really important for students that are entering an office environment where not everything is assigned to you, where you need to have your own sort of intellectual independence and flexibility and resilience when things don't go exactly the way you've planned. So
that makes perfect sense. Hannah, does that gel with you?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah. Well, you know, and that's such a great thing to learn as you get into the workforce. Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing that. Congratulations, sure. Hannah, on graduating this month.
Thank you for sharing
a little bit about your research. Thank you, Dr. Ebben. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Dr. Nisetich, for all the work you do in supporting students. We are extremely proud of professors that we have, and they are all fantastic. And what we really love about what you do particularly is that you care so deeply about your students. So thank you, both of you.